How do games manage lots of objects moving around at the same time? If you're curious like me, you probably wondered how games manage physics objects and move them around in a scene. Computers are powerful, but still limited. They must take shortcuts to make complex scenes of lots of moving objects, but still make it seem believable. Recently, I've been working on an open source character controller project. How a player interacts with a game and how a character interacts with the environment is important to creating a good experience. In almost every game, a player will interact somehow with the environment, whether it's simply not clipping through objects and moving through static scenes such as in Celeste, or a complex interaction with moving objects such as in Fall Guys. In this video, I'll be discussing how within the Unity game engine we can use physics objects to design character collisions and game experiences. You can try out this project for yourself in your web browser at the link in the description. There's also a link to the open source project in the description if you want to read up on how it works on your own. This is the second video in a series explaining the OpenKCC project. The previous is linked in the card discussing an overview of designing character controllers. When designing a character controller, it's key that its interactions are well-defined for the physics environment to create a natural response. You wouldn't want to have a car in a racing game struggle to scale a small hill, nor would you want a player to be shoved through the floor when opening a door. Modern game engines such as Unity contain a physics system for 2D and 3D environments that supports moving objects. Within these systems, there are generally three different kinds of physics objects. 1. Dynamic, 2. Static, and 3. Kinematic. Talking about these objects in an abstract world is hard to understand. Let's play a game of pool. See these pool balls moving around here? They have a mass, shape, and deflect off each other when they collide. These would be dynamic objects, as they can be pushed by other objects and other objects can push them. When the ball hits the side of the table, they bounce off. No matter how fast the balls move, they won't push the table around. In real life, this is achieved through large objects or a sturdy support, but in games it's easier to simply cheat and mark static objects which don't move. Also, whenever a ball is hit with a pool cue, the cue pushes the ball around. For the purposes of this game, the ball should never push the cue around. Since the cue hits, but cannot be hit by the dynamic pool balls, it would be a kinematic object. For me, it's helpful to visualize these objects in a grid with the horizontal axis defining if other objects push this, and the vertical axis defining if this can push other objects. Dynamic objects like the pool balls would be in the top left, both pushing each other around and being pushed by other objects. The pool table is in the bottom right, and both does not move and cannot be moved by other objects. And the pool cue, which can push other objects, but not be pushed around itself, would be in the top right, where it can push the pool balls around, but not be pushed by other objects. Given this example, you might ask yourself, what would happen if a kinematic object hit a static object? Who would win? An unstoppable force or an immovable object coming together? Well, if we test it for ourselves by having an unstoppable kinematic object rocket towards a static surface, we find that things simply pass through each other with no interaction. It's rather underwhelming. How does this relate to character controllers again? Well, if a game has moving objects, which, let's face it, most games do, and you want your player to interact with those objects, again, probably yes, you need to define your character within the physics system. From the example before, you can see how the pool cue could act as a kinematic character controller of a player that hits the pool balls into pockets around the table. Let's look into some examples that might help illustrate this. Look at the game Portal 2. It has very few moving and colliding objects. Great! You can use a static character controller where you simply have the character move around via teleporting short distances. This means the normally built-in character controller in most game engines. Unity is called a character controller and will be referred to as built-in character controller from here on. The built-in character controller won't interact with physics objects unless you write some custom code. The built-in character controller has some nice features like gravity, walking up and down stairs, and not sliding down small hills. You'll see why that's important soon. Let's look at another game like Rocket League, where the player controls a car rocketing around and hitting a giant soccer ball into goals around the arena. This would be an example of a dynamic object. In Unity, dynamic objects are achieved using a rigid body component, since this component gives an object mass, gravity, and collisions. This will be referred to as a rigid body character controller from now on. Rigid body controllers come with a few caveats, such as not being able to stand on slopes due to gravity pulling them down, and getting stuck on the edge of steps when attempting to walk up and down them. This is great for some games, such as Rock of Ages, where you roll a boulder down a hill at fast speeds, but not as fun for precise platformers or first-person shooters where precision is key. Let's move on to the last kind of physics object. Kinematic. Kinematic character controllers, or KCC for short, are another important addition. Just as with kinematic objects, they can push other objects around, but other objects do not push them. They are very similar to built-in character controllers, but have a few key advantages. 1. They can use different shapes in the built-in character controller. 2. They come with physics interactivity. And 3. They can be any kind of object and aren't limited to humanoids, and you could even use a kinematic character controller to make something like a pool cue. Now we get to the hard part. How do you decide what kind of character controller to use in your game? First, we can look at the physics interactions. Should a character push other objects, and can it be pushed by other objects? This, we can fill out information with our physics types as we discussed earlier. Remember, the built-in is static, the rigid body is dynamic, and the kinematic character controller is, well, kinematic. The rigid body and kinematic character controllers can easily push other objects, and the built-in character controller can push other objects, but would require some custom modifications. Both the built-in and kinematic character controllers will not be pushed by other objects, while the rigid body will be pushed by other objects. This might be enough for determining how your player will interact with the world around them, but if not, there are a few more criteria you can consider. This description is not exhaustive, and there is still more left to cover. Consider how objects in a game you like to play may be divided up. I'll dive into a few case studies from existing games in future videos, so subscribe if you're interested to hear more about this. Not all character controllers are physics-based. There are entirely UI-based, such as from one of my favorites, A Dark Room. I didn't cover these in the video as they are out of scope, but could be an interesting future topic. I also love playing base-building and strategy games like StarCraft and the Civilization series. They usually have an omniscient perspective and UI-based controls by clicking on elements in the environment or tapping with touchscreens. These kinds of games have a special place in my heart. They also include quite a bit of character controller design as well. The list of the video games that are used in this video appear in the description in the order in which they appear if you are interested in learning more about those games. Let me know what you think in the comments below. I know I mentioned the code is open source before. This means that if you want to, you can submit a code change or open an issue for an error, or submit a feature request. The code is open source, and I appreciate any feedback you can get. Again, the demo website and GitHub project are linked in the description if you want to check it out. Have a great day!